Welcome to Chemistry with Caroline. In this video, we're going to look at how to correctly use mechanistic arrows in organic chemistry. So we use arrows to show how a chemical reaction proceeds, which bonds are broken and which bonds are made. And I like to think of arrows as the language of organic chemistry. They really are the directions for how the reaction proceeds. And we're going to be doing mechanisms for about 3/4 of the year in organic chemistry. So it's really important that you know how to use these arrows. Then you will apply them to each unique chemical reaction you encounter. So first things first, arrows always start at electrons. Okay, now I'm gonna say it again. Arrows always start at electrons, okay? So if you're writing on your exam and you look down and you see that you have arrows, and it's not starting at electrons, you need to erase it. So what do I mean by that? I have a chemical reaction written below here, and in this chemical reaction, it's an acid-base reaction. A proton is transferred from one species to the other. So we have this proton here that ends up on the water molecule over here on the product side. So the hydroxide, one of its lone pairs of electrons, is going to attached to that proton. So you're going to have an arrow starting at a lone pair of electrons on the hydroxide oxygen and ending at the proton that it is taking. The bond between the oxygen and the hydrogen on my acid is breaking, so my arrow will start at the electrons in that bond and it'll end at the oxygen atom because that oxygen atom is accepting those electrons. That's why it becomes negative on the other side, on my product side. So if we are to label these arrows, let's say one here and two here, these arrows can show the formation and breaking of bonds. So arrow one is going to be indicating that that bond between the oxygen that was a hydroxide and the proton on the acid formed to make water. And then arrow two is going to indicate that a carboxylate ion is formed, that oxygen that did have the proton on it is now going to be negative. So now we know that arrows will always begin at electrons, but where will they end? An arrow should end either at an atom that is accepting electrons or at the location of a bond that is being formed. So this example below is an elimination reaction, and it'll allow us to see multiple iterations of how arrows work and the ways in which they would communicate the information about bonds being broken and made. So in this reaction, I'm forming a double bond and then some byproducts that are inorganic. So it begins with my hydroxide ion plucking off the proton from my organic compound. So my arrows begin at the lone pair of electrons and they end at the proton on my organic molecule. This will break the bond between the carbon and the hydrogen. So my arrow would start there and it's going to form a new double bond. So it's forming a pi bond that will make a double bond in my product. So my arrow ends in the middle of that bond to indicate that a pi bond is being formed. And then lastly, the bromine is going to leave and take electrons with it so as not to exceed the octet rule. So my arrow will begin at the bond between carbon and bromine and end at the bromine atom, which is taking those electrons with it. So if we were to label our arrows again. So let's say one, two, and three. Arrow one indicates that a new bond is being formed between the hydroxide oxygen and the proton that was on the organic starting material. So that would tell me about this bond formation. Arrow two is indicating that a pi bond is being formed and a double bond will be present in my final product. The arrow ended in the middle of that bond to indicate that a double bond was forming between those two carbon atoms. So this pi bond there is what's being indicated by arrow two. And lastly, the bromine left. It accepted electrons and became a bromide on the product side. And that is indicated by arrow three. So all of the arrows here begin at electrons and all of the arrows end either at an atom that's accepting electrons or they indicate the formation of a new bond. So let's look at one more example. This is just a part of a chemical reaction, so we're looking at one step, but it shows the breakage of a pi bond. So I think it's another type of mechanism that you'll see and another good example to be familiar with. So in this case, this nitrogen has two lone pairs of electrons on it. One of these lone pairs is going to bond to this carbon atom over here. And just from looking at the product, we should start to be able to predict how our arrows should go. We see that in the product, the nitrogen is bonded to the carbon, right? So a lone pair must have then come in and attacked that carbon. Now the oxygen went from having a double bond to a single bond, which means that the pi bond is breaking. So those electrons are going to shift from being shared between oxygen and carbon to being pushed up onto the oxygen atom. So let's keep with our labeling. So here's arrow one and here's arrow two. Arrow one indicates the formation of a new bond between carbon and nitrogen to me. Arrow two indicates that the oxygen atom is breaking a pi bond between it and carbon and accepting those electrons as a lone pair of electrons. And so now it's going to be negatively charged. So I've shown you some different examples of the types of bond breakage and formation that occurs in organic chemistry and how we use arrows to convey that information. If you found this video helpful, please like, subscribe, share with your friends. If there's a topic that you want me to cover and you don't see it on Chemistry with Caroline, let me know in the comments below, and I'll be happy to make a new video. See you next time.